Like one of my friends also recently got scammed and she met this guy on an online dating app. So all her life savings is basically like gone. Hi everyone and welcome to GovTech Decoded, where we decode technical speak. In this series, we'll discuss hot tech topics and how the Singapore government leverages technologies to build tech for public good. I'm GovTechie Alicia.
I'm GovTechie Andre.
And we are your hosts for today's episode.
Hey Alicia, have you received one of those messages to tell you last chance to invest or like jobs immediately available?
Yeah, I keep getting them there. Do you know how to stop?
You know what? I have some idea. But I'll let our guests here, Bryan and Chloe, explain a little bit more. Welcome Bryan and Chloe. Yay!
Hello everyone, I'm Bryan here. So I'm from the Government IT Security Incident Response Team. We are responsible for incident response and investigations against cyber threats in the Singapore government. Chloe, how about you?
Well, hi, I'm Chloe. I'm from GovTech's anti-scams products team, and we mainly look at developing products that detect, disrupt, and deter scams.
So for a start, maybe we can share with our audience what exactly is cybersecurity and why is it important?
Yeah, so actually, I'm a cybersecurity specialist myself, and most time people associate cybersecurity with hacking or some other cybercrime. But actually, cybersecurity is more than that. It is about protecting your data, your apps, your systems, your networks. Bryan, what do you think though?
Well, so to me, cybersecurity is not just about us protecting your systems against cyber threats, but it's also about empowering the people to protect themselves against threats and scams through the necessary awareness campaigns or even education. Right, so actually my mother-in-law also fell prey to a scam recently. So you all started with a Facebook advertisement advertising on roasted meat. And the seller insisted for my mother-in-law to perform a deposit of $5 through an Android application. So once the app is installed, her phone basically got compromised and the scammer started to send messages to all her contacts to borrow money, right? So it was a very traumatizing experience for her. And the lessons learned from this is that we should never download and install applications that we are not familiar with.
This roasted meat very expensive. Somebody's favorite. It's somebody's favorite.
Yeah. But actually, it's not just the older people who get scammed. Even among my friends, whom I consider quite tech-savvy, I've heard of similar stories involving bank phishing scams. Like one of them was quite high-profile. I think a couple of years back in December, there were a few banks that got compromised. And yeah, I had a friend who actually lost a sum. But thankfully, during that period, it was also recovered. It's really like any one of us can get scammed.
Like one of my friends also recently got scammed and she lost the money and didn't get it back. So it was like a long drawn con, I guess. So she met this guy on an online dating app and then like they had a textual relationship, right? And he showed her pictures of himself and all that. And then he said that, oh, he was working at a bank and they had this special product. So it started small, right? He went to a link and then it was like a trading platform. You put in 1,000, then you got back a bit more than 1,000. So okay, you try again, 2,000, then you got more than 2,000. So I put in like all my money. Then it got locked. The password is has some issues. And that was when like they realized that it was a scam and then they reported the police, but they never got it back. So all her life savings is basically like gone. And she's not old lah, but you know, it's like you're 20 something and then you have to start over from scratch.
So these are also reflective of the national crime statistics that the police have released last year. So last year, they reported 50,000 scam cases and cyber crimes. The top three scam cases were job scams, e-commerce scams, and fake friend call scams. And you know what, guys? 40% of these scam victims were aged 30 to 49. So that's not old people, that's us there.
Dun, 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 dun. After that, everybody is like, come and scam us.
So the big reason why all these scams have grown so big is because of the nature of social media platforms. Nowadays, it's very hard to catch them due to the sheer volume of messages, ads, posts that are on social media. And this makes it very difficult to discover them. And at the same time, through social media platforms, these scams are very easily propagated to a larger audience.
Like roasted meat.
Like your mom-in-law. Yeah.
I also thought that this is so the challenge for this platforms to really combat the scams because when these are posted, let's say on Facebook, they seem really legit. So it's really hard to stop them.
So actually I want to ask, if people, touch wood, are in a situation where they get scammed. So Bryan, you mentioned your mother-in-law phone got hacked, then the hacker was also messaging her friends. So if I get caught in such a situation, like what should I do?
Right, so in such circumstances, personally, what I would do is, the first step I would do is I would cut off the scammer access to my phone. So I'll do that by removing a SIM card, disabling all the Wi-Fi access. So once that's done, I would then use a spare phone to log into my existing applications. And then from there, I will terminate any existing sessions on other devices, right? And once these are done, I will then check for any suspicious transactions. For example, are there any suspicious transfers on my iBanking application? And then lastly, I will proceed to file a police report. Mm. Yeah.
So methodical, you know? Just cut your phone, burn it, set up shop somewhere
else.
Everybody
must put down all these like three, four, five steps that y'all must do, okay?
It sounds like almost Bryan has rehearsed this or like, you know, thought about this a long time.
He went through,
I went through for my mother-in-law. Yeah.
So that's what you did for your mother-in-law.
First-hand experience. Okay, so now scammers are also getting more sophisticated, right? Last time they used to be very dodgy kind of URLs, and it's HTTP, not HTTPS. But now everybody is like upgraded. Okay, so what are some precautions that we should take in the first place to prevent ourselves from getting into these kind of situations?
Talking about what Bryan was saying just now, just don't download anything that looks sus. You know, if it's from an unknown source, if somebody sent it to you, especially if it's .apk and you need to install it and give it extra permissions, like it's just a food purchasing app, but then they need your location, contacts, access to files and everything, then this is no. Just don't do it, guys. Don't do it.
And also watch out for time pressure tactics. So these scammers, they like to use time pressure tactics or, you know, things to make you feel FOMO and then you act rashly and regret later.
I think recently scammers have also started using AI, right, in their scam. So that's why you have like, last time you can see them from the bad grammar, and now they can use ChatGPT and fix all the grammar, make it look super professional, right? Absolutely. And how else can they be using AI to scam us?
Right, so circling back to the scam which happened to my mother-in-law, what amazes me was that the scammer was actually able to send voice messages to her contacts, which really resemble her voice, and even speaking the dialect that she used to speak, right? So this is likely through the application of the deepfake audios that's created through AI. And if I reference to a report that was shared by the cybersecurity agencies of Singapore, 13% of the scams evaluated in 2023 were likely generated by AI.
Wow, that's a lot.
Anyway, so if your mother-in-law like just send you, hello, send me money, then you would just send her money. Like, it was so real that you would have believed it.
Confirm one. You see, look at his face.
Well, I mean,
you
see.
Best son-in-law. Best son-in-law in Singapore.
40%, you will be one of them already.
In that case, would you then think AI is detrimental to cybersecurity?
Well, we can't really always wear that lens, right, with technology. So I personally don't think so. I think, you know, as much as malicious actors, which is like bad guys, use AI to improve their scamming techniques, we can also use AI to improve our scam detection and cyber defense. It's a double-edged sword. The problem is not the technology itself, but in how the technology is used. And I think AI is here to stay. It's so ingrained in our lives now. So what we should focus on is not just being scared, but we should focus on how we can best use AI for good.
You mentioned that AI has improved cyber defense. Could you elaborate more about it?
Of course, happy to. In fact, it's something you might be familiar with because I'm from the GovTech anti-scam product team, and so are you. And we focus on anti-scam products. So one product that I'm working on is the recursive ML machine learning site evaluator, which is essentially a URL classifier that leverages some machine learning to evaluate potential scam sites using their technical attributes. So these sites are then submitted by Sartis to Google Web Risk, which then blocks these sites. So Andre, you're more familiar with Sartis as it's your brainchild. No, so right, how about you
true.
Tell us more
that's
about
true.
It?
Fine. So Sartis stands for Scam Analytics and Tactical Intervention System. It is the collaboration between MHA, GovTech and the industry. So just now earlier, I shared that there were 50,000 scam cases reported last year. That translates to 130 cases each day. So that's actually a lot of scam victims a day and a lot of workload for the police officers as well. So we thought to ourselves, why not fight tech with tech, right? So if the scammers are using deepfake AI, we should also have our own AI to combat this. So we built a system to proactively hunt for websites in the World Wide Web and take them down automatically using AI. And today, I'm proud to tell you that SETIS, together with RMSC, analyzes more than 1 million sites a month. And when we block those websites automatically, it's promulgated to more than 5 billion devices worldwide.
Wow. Saving the world, guys. Superhero. Yeah.
5 billion or not 5 million? Yeah, 5 billion with a B.
So we have RMSC and SETIS to block malicious sites, to block scam calls and messages. There's a Scam Shield app that identifies and blocks them on your phone. Recently, the government also introduced a common SMS sender ID to help users identify legit SMSs from the government, which is from gov.sg. This is to counter the common tactic used to impersonate government agencies or public officers.
Alright, so another tip for users is look out for go.gov.sg links in various government distributed messages. So this is a URL shortener that can only be used by public officer. So if you receive that, you can be sure that it will be from a trustworthy source.
It's very easy to fall prey to messages when it's regarding something like getting your vaccination or redeeming your CDC voucher, especially when there's money involved. So remind people around you to only click on go.gov.sg links.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, noted.
So Chloe, earlier you also mentioned that a lot of scams take place on social media. So do you guys think, like, what's the role of the companies in preventing scams?
Well, I definitely think they have a big role to play because, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. Right? So I don't think users will want to use an app or a platform if they're not assured that the platform is secure enough to use, where they can confidently use it and be assured that they're not likely to get scammed, or at least a very, very low likelihood. So I think it is definitely in these companies, social media companies, best interest to really deploy whatever tech they can and whatever operations or initiatives they can to reduce scams on these platforms.
I agree with Chloe. So there needs to be a balance between efforts put in from these platforms in actively preventing the scams versus users who need to also stay vigilant when they are using these platforms.
We have come to the end of today's episode. If you are keen to find out more about what we have discussed, you can check our website at go.gov.sg/govtechdecoded.
If you enjoyed this episode, do support us by sharing it with others and on social media. You can also connect with our speakers on their LinkedIn pages and follow GovTech on our social media platforms at go.gov.sg/connectwithgovtech. We will leave the links in the description. I'm Alicia.
And I'm Andre. And we'll catch you in the next GovTech Decoded.